Hey guys, what's up? This is Carl.
Hey gang, Brian.
And this is the Brewed Awakening, where we tell you what Mr. Z is doing with some beers.
You heard?
All right, so we got a couple quick things today. We got three topics we're going to talk about.
Boom.
Let's just roll right into it. We got the Double Dutch Rudder, which we've had before.
Double Dutch is back.
Nice. It was when I first started here back in January. It was like on tap for like three more weeks, more take, and it was my favorite beer.
Cool.
I loved it. So for anyone that doesn't know what the Double Dutch Rudder is, what is it?
All right. It's our base Muddy Tugger brown ale, the honey variety, and then we got it into Scotch barrels. As always, you're picking up a lot of great barrel quality, a little bit of the spirits and the Scotch, but I'm picking up a lot of lignin, a lot of vanilla characteristic.
Okay. Yeah.
So the vanilla is coming through nicely. And then outside of that, there's a little bit of a tannin load. This is the fourth time use on this barrel. I think moving forward, when we barrel age our brown, we're going into bourbon barrels, and we're just going to call it the old triple Dutch Rudder.
Double, there you go.
Yeah. So I love me a good single malt scotch. I really do.
Yeah.
But as far as barrel usage in beer, bourbon's the bee's knees. So I think we'll take it in that direction moving forward. That said, like, this is still a dope beer. Anything barrel aged is awesome.
So. Yeah, for sure. I mean, at home, if I go out buy anything and it sits in my refrigerator, it's always barrel aged. I just somehow know it's barrel aged and buy it.
Man, so. Keith has an awesome relationship with the Bloms, and we just have barrel accessibility like for days. So we're getting into some barrel-aged coffee beans. We've been doing its due diligence as far as research, and we should be kind of, let's see, between George at Jumble and the Bloms and Keith.
It's like a bunch of mad scientists working together.
It's cool, yeah. It's no doubt
with
about
you,
it.
Yeah. Then with you in the back end, so, just taking everyone's stuff and.
Oh, we're not taking, buddy. Like, I'd like to think I contribute too.
But yeah, so the first Double Dutch Rudder, was that the one last year? Was that the first time you guys did the Double Dutch Rudder, or was that like a second?
I want to say, is this the third time we released the Double Dutch?
So was last year's Scotch barreled also?
Yes.
So it's always been Scotch barreled.
It's always been Scotch barreled.
So then when you said we're going to switch to bourbon, that would be the triple.
Let's triple Dutch it.
Okay.
For sure.
I think we're going to have to make Zach and Mary make a porno version too then. If we call this the triple Dutch.
Coffee beans.
Right, so. There we go. But awesome. I'm looking forward to it. And I think we're going to release that this weekend, right?
Yeah, let's go for it.
Awesome.
It's ready.
So it's ready to go. Why not give it to the world mass?
Absolutely.
Why you keep sitting on it, right?
Right.
Awesome. So that is not what we're drinking. What we're drinking is our seven-headed monster, but
seven-headed.
With a little twist.
We unfiltered it. It was kind of a, two different products, the Monin and Gronin and the Seven-Headed. I wanted to take into unfiltered territory.
Okay.
The filters, a lot of pros and cons. One of the big cons is it's just wildly inefficient, especially with water usage. So we want to drive that water usage rate down. Since we're going in with the secondary ingredient in the fermenter with the dry hop, running it through the filter is always kind of a concern. So you're kind of losing your yield. You're using a lot of water. But you're not getting as much beer.
Sure.
In a nutshell.
Okay.
So let's drive that water usage rate. Water is a commodity, obviously. So let's try to be a little bit responsible.
Yeah, for sure.
I know it's shocking, but the brewing industry is not super efficient with water.
Really?
We're moving in the right direction. I promise.
So when I tell people I'm hydrating with my beer with water, I'm going to be less hydrated when I drink the Seven Headed now. Because there's less water.
Oh, no, it's just running the filter in general uses a lot of water.
I see. Okay.
Yeah, we're not watering it down at all. But
I was meaning you're getting less water out of
it. Just as far as, like, just say cleaning process.
Got you. Okay, that makes more sense now.
For sure.
Okay, awesome. Because I love beer. I still don't understand all the processes. You've been helping me out a lot. But
you know what? In 20 years, maybe I'll understand all the processes.
All right.
We'll get there.
In 20 years, it'll be probably crazy how you'll do it from now. But awesome.
Yeah, so there's going to be a little bit more haziness there, but you know what? One concern as far as cons with any sort of filtration process, whether you're finding or using a cross-flow filter or DE or whatever it may be, is losing a little bit of the flavor and aroma characteristics of the beer, especially with a hoppy beer like this where a lot of the essential oils are so volatile.
Yeah.
Like, they're intense, they're awesome, but they're going to fade quickly too. So, theoretically, and I've noticed, or maybe it's just power of perception, I don't know, but it seems like this is more flavor forward than the filtered one.
Definitely got more bite to it, you know, with that hoppiness to it. Because I always told people, like, our IPAs weren't too bitey or too bitter. You know, they didn't have that like huge bite that a lot of people don't or love about it. This one definitely does.
This is awesome, yeah, man. This has like a real pleasant, sharp bitter to it. Okay. But it's so balanced with the sweetness on the flip side that we've converted a lot of non-IPA drinkers to IPAs with this beer. This is. It's not a small one. It's 7 ABV, 77 IBU. But you know what? It's so balanced that we're getting people in and really appreciating this. So this is blowing up a little bit. State Fair did really, really well there. Yeah. It's doing really well in the Des Moines market.
It's been our number one selling beer, I think, for the past couple months now, too.
It's been number two to distro and number two in-house. And if you combine both of them, then, I think it's number one.
Yeah, so, total sales.
For sure.
Yeah, it's getting up there.
This is not Bell's Too Hearted, man, but this is our Bell's Too Hearted. It's just balanced and well done, through and through, for sure.
I agree with that. And then you guys bottled yesterday, or you guys spent the past 2 days bottling.
Yes.
Is that the first bottle that's going to be unfiltered?
Heard. Yep.
Nice. Because I know I was sitting there drinking it yesterday, and I didn't know it was unfiltered. I was like, kind of has a different bite to it. But I was just thinking, okay, maybe it's just fresh off the press, but.
That too.
Yeah, it tastes juicier when it's out there. Dude, it tastes so good.
One of my favorite things to do is empty the bright tank the day of or day before bunch of products go out to distro.
Yeah.
So, like, literally, Ryan just filled up 2 half barrels to send to Des Moines of this product. Today, I'm like, oh, man, like, day of product? That's always cool.
Right.
For sure.
Awesome. So, we got one more thing to talk about.
Yeah.
We kind of took a hiatus off kombucha for a while, just... you know, processes and just being backed up.
Being a little backed up. We're still not opening up to growler fills yet, but that will be coming up.
For sure.
What's on deck? We're moving out of the ginger cardamom. That is almost finished, and we're getting into masala. So that's a spice blend, masala chai.
Okay.
What is it like? I got cheat sheet here. Blah, blah, blah. Cardamom, cinnamon, cloves, ginger, nutmeg, black pepper.
Okay.
So we're taking it in a spicy direction. And then me and you were just talking yesterday.
Yeah.
We have some blood orange puree from Oregon Fruit.
Yeah.
So I think after the masala, let's get into that. And then I got some cranberry puree as well.
That worked great just in Thanksgiving
and
time.
Thanksgiving, Christmas, and then let's spice it up a little bit.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, kombucha is great. If you're not sure really what it is, it's just basically, at the end of the day, fermented tea, some science to it, and then you just add some flavor to it.
It's if you're consuming yogurt for the probiotics, this is like... yogurt on steroids,
right. It tastes good. Sure. You can do a lot of great flavors with it. It kind of has its own unique taste to it. So your first time, you're like, ooh, what? Really? But then, you kind
of... There's always a funkiness to it. Right. I mean, there's a lot of microbes living in there. But at the same time, like, when I open up the mother batch, I usually get blasted in the face with, a lot of, pear sort of ester.
Yep, I get that for sure.
There's a lot of complexity there. Yep. Like, all the complexities of brewing with... the funkiness of kombucha. So.
Yeah. I mean, we do that at home. Riley, kicks out 5 gallons every month for
That's
us
awesome.
At home. And I get the same thing. So maybe one of these videos we'll do a little more in depth about what kombucha is. And everyone can see what a SCOBY looks like because that thing's insane.
Oh, we got some nice looking SCOBYs over there. Nice white and matty. They're healthy.
Right. Awesome.
Yeah, for
cool,
sure.
Man. Awesome. Well,
cool.
Cheers, buddy. And don't forget, we got the Double Dutch Rudder releasing this weekend. We got the new filtered IPA. He just literally put this on the tap 5 minutes before we started.
Yeah. So. Also, do me a favor and drink the Double Dutch as quickly as possible because our Russian Imperial Barrel Age is right behind it, and I'm really looking forward to that one.
Ooh.
So, all right, shall we touch
cheers,
our tips?
Bud. All right, guys, take it easy.
I win.
Yes.